Hello, gang. Before I look at License to Kill, the video will be about both of the Dalton films together because there was only two, so I don't know how long a video will be. Needless to say, it's Living Daylights, especially, of course, being the first one, is a breath of fresh air after a few to a kill. Whatever you think about few to a kill, Living Daylights sort of brings it all back together. There's a much more serious feel to the film. There's attempts at humour. Dalton's one line has always seemed to be interrupted by something. You know, the boot line, the plane, you know, he got the boot, the plane almost hits a mountain. When he says, I'm sure you understand. The car windows come up. Mount, I don't know. Dalton could handle it, I'd imagine, but that is not helped. And also, this Bond is always startled by animals jumping on him. That being said, excuse me, Dalton is my favourite Bond because I think he's close to Fleming's, and apparently he did do a lot of reading, or at least he read. Not everyone does when they're preparing for a role. And as best as he can, because I think he had disagreements with John Glenn on both of his films, he was able to bring Bond from the pages, I think, better than most have before and since. And certainly he got there ahead of Daniel Craig in the serious stakes of Bond. I mean, Craig's Bond is more of a sort of broody teenager in comparison to Dalton's Bond. Daylights has some fantastic stunts, which it looks like Dalton does as best as he can to do as much as he can. Roger Moore didn't do too much of that, especially towards the end, and you know, the stunt doubles was far too obvious in Few to a Kill, unfortunately. However, it's got some fantastic characters within it. Koskov and Saunders are underrated in their way. Both of them, you go, when you first meet them, you have opposing views to which you have at the end of the film. For instance, Saunders is a stuffed shirt, civil servant type who has no time for Bond and bemoans Bond when Bond shoots the sniper in the hand and not doesn't kill her. Koskov is all charming, you immediately sort of like him, he has charisma. And then over the course of the film, of course, Koskov is the villain as such, and Saunders becomes a likeable chap, hence when he's killed, it's awfully shocking, and the manner he dies is awfully shocking as well. Koskov, but at the end of the film, gets his comeuppance, and you're glad when that happens. Pushkin, by John Rhys-Davies, is an utterly incredible character. Shame he didn't come back for GoldenEye like apparently he was meant to, for various reasons why not. And works with Bond rather well. That scene in the hotel, you know, you should have brought Lily's, is a fantastic example of Timothy Dalton, in action. Dalton, you know, Bond doesn't need to be a Hulk as such or a physical threat. Part of Bond's danger is that he could be any of us on the street with the capability to kill. And when he kills, it's usually with a gun, but you know, he's capable of a punch-up, Timothy Dalton's Bond, but it's not like obvious, whereas in Casino Royale Daniel Craig was bulked up when he wasn't beforehand. It's a minor criticism of Craig's Bond, but the whole idea of Bond, I think, is that he's relatively ordinary. Sure, a very handsome chap in the books and the like, but he makes mistakes, he makes errors. He gets suckered in sometimes by an attractive woman, and to a point Dalton does in Living Daylights. Kara is an intriguing character to me. I never much cared for her when I was younger. But now, though she's not the best Bond girl, there is a slight complex nature to her. Like Stacy, she's sort of a normal girl, albeit unlike Stacy, she's sort of been suckered into it before Bond met her, and she's meant to be this sniper that is meant to kill Koskov as he defects, or at least she's there to make the defection look serious. And of course Bond shoots her in the hand because she's a woman, but Bond has a sixth sense, I think, that she's not what she appears to be, despite Kostkov's claim that some of the best KGB snipers are women. She is hopelessly in love with Kostkov and then becomes hopelessly in love with Bond. So she's got foibles, and she is sort of like one half of a very good humorous moment when they've just escaped from the base in Afghanistan. Well, no, two parts actually. When they defeat the jailers, and she says, "James, we're free," and he just looks at her and goes, "Kara, we're in the middle of Soviet Air Force Base in the middle of Afghanistan." And then when they escape and get rescued by Art Malik's men, you know, he said they say something, and she goes, "What's that? Well, they won't kill us now. Now, what about later?" It's a nice looking film. It maybe had a different direction and photography at these scenes doubling up as Afghanistan would look quite decent. They do anyway, and John Barry's music helps. And indeed, it's Barry's last Bond score, and he cameos at the end as a conductor. It's got a very 80s sound compared to his previous two soundtracks for Future of Kill and Octopussy. I mean, alright, Future of Kill's got the theme song, but it doesn't really spill over into the soundtrack itself, whereas Living Daylights, as you hear in the opening of this video, it's got Hercules Takeoff, Airborne, League Cross Attacks, they have that very 80s sound, a late 80s sound. And the title song's is okay. I think it's the only other song people know by A-ha. Barry preferred the other song, Where Is Everybody Gone? And needless to say, Joe Don Baker's first of three Bond appearances is a bit of a letdown, really. Whitaker's meant to be the actual villain of the film working with Kostkov, and yet it doesn't quite come off that way. Whether that's Baker's acting, the direction, to the point that when Bond has, done everything in Afghanistan and goes to get Whitaker, it sort of feels like it's tacked on for the sake of it. It does give you Kostkov's payoff by Pushkin, but there's just something not right about it. And then you get the bridge to the last scene with Bond's little gadget. It does have my favourite Bond car, and indeed Aston Martin full stop, and that's the Aston Martin V8 Vantage Volante, or Volante Vantage, because technically it's a Volante when you first see it in action, because the roof is down, and then it's a Vantage afterwards. It's reappearing in No Time to Die, and Corgi have brought out a brand spanking new version, model for it, and they've branded it as No Time to Die. Despite the fact it's the Living Daylights Aston, and unlike the Daylights Aston, hang on, smooth. You don't have it, do you? Let's have a look. Oh god, I sure clearly didn't think this through. Hang on, there you go. Optional extras, the skis. There you go. And indeed, Bond probably isn't going to blow it up like he does in Daylights. I'm sure I'm forgetting something, but we'll press on to License to Kill. I personally think this is one of the best Bond movies. It has a fantastically realistic plot for a Bond film. The bad guy's a drug dealer. Bond's going after him to, or drug lord, sorry. Bond's going after him to get revenge for what he's done to his mate Felix Leiter. People don't care for it. They say the budget was, well, it wasn't a good budget, but there was already the legal problems that would stop Bond being made into a GoldenEye were coming into view. It was largely all filmed over in Mexico, Mexico and Florida. So people say it looks like a sort of like a feature length Miami Vice episode, and the theme, the plot of the film doesn't help. I think the title song doesn't work for the film. It's a good song, Gladys Knight is a good singer, and all right, Bond songs don't always go with what happens in the film. Like Moonraker is a bit of a soft song for a film that ultimately Bond goes into space and stuff. Diamonds Are Forever, for example, I think goes rather well with what the film does. You Only Live Twice, etc. But License to Kill, the first ever 15-rated Bond film over here, anyway. It's, you know, the film's about revenge and there's all nasty stuff in it. A guy gets his head blown up, and the song, you know. And that's the thing. This is Bond. I mean, the thing is, when Timothy Dalton is your favourite Bond actor, you invariably are going to bump up the films he did. George Lazenby, I think, is my second favourite Bond, and HMS is my favourite Bond film. Daylights and License to Kill usually in my top five. I mean, the rankings have changed. I've given From Russia with Love a 10-10 this time around. It's usually a 9-10, which means technically it's joint first with HMSS. Now, I give License to Kill always a 9-10. And it's multifold. Forget how the film looks. It's how it goes, how Bond goes about it. You know, in the pre-title sequence, there's this drug lord Sanchez that Bond gets wound, sort of drawn into. Because he's going on his way to Felix's wedding. Brilliant stunt, rightly, and the music's not too bad for it as well. Michael Kamen. And then you get the titles. And that's a good thing about License to Kill, is that Felix Leiter is the late David Hedison, who sadly died this year. And he's the first Felix to reprise his role, something like, what, 16 years after Live and Let Die, and not until Jeffrey Wright in Quantum of Solace did Felix return with the same actor, and I think he's in No Time to Die as well. And that means that he's going to be the first actor to play Felix in more than two films. John Terry in Living Daylights just wasn't worth a serious mention. Sorry, John Terry. However, Sanchez is a really solid character, I think. He's played rather well by Robert Davi. Davi says that him and Dalton both read Casino Royale to sort of get a feel for things and make Bond, you know, serious as such. And so Sanchez is a drug lord. His plan basically is just drugs. He takes revenge on Felix, feeds Felix to the shark. And that gives you, sorry, pigeons and that were flying out my window. That gives you one of the most disturbing moments, I think, in a Bond film anyway, because Benicio del Toro is playing Sanchez's key man Dario, and Dario has gone to the house to get Felix, but at the same time, does something to his wife, a new wife, Della, and Della is responsible beforehand for one of the rare mentions or hints of Tracy, when, you know, Bond doesn't really want her gart or whatever. He just wants to get away from this wedding, and she sort of just wouldn't let it go, and he walks off with the garter, looking brilliant, Dalton expression. And Felix just says, you know, he was married once a long time ago, and it's like, and then they go in the house, and Felix is dangling there, and he goes, "Where's my wife?" And Dario goes, "We gave her a nice honeymoon." Now, you could laugh at that line, I suppose, how it's done, but it's creepy as hell, I think. And the implication, of course, is that he's done. And it's like, whoa. You know, and Felix is fed to the shark. And I remember I wasn't allowed to watch this film probably until I turned 14, 13, 14. And whenever it was shown on ITV, I mean, ITV do have a habit of butchering films because it's a commercial channel and they slap commercials in it. But the certain scenes, I mean, it was never worth watching the film off ITV. And we didn't have Freeview and DC. It was all on terrestrial TV. And it was never a film we got on video until we got the Ultimate Collection. So it was a while, and it stayed in my memory since then. Because you've got the infamous Anthony Serp's head blown, the infamous moment where Anthony Serp's head gets in the pressure chamber. It is a grim scene for a Bond film, beyond grim. You know, I mean, there's been attempts since that film probably to match it. It shows you Sanchez's brutality and the nature of his character, and it's the fact Bond just watches it. with a grim face, but Spawn knows what Sanchez is capable of by now. And it's also the plot is, I think, kind of intricate. You know, the whole, like, Bond goes rogue because M wouldn't, doesn't want him to go after, M won't let him go after Sanchez, and it's how he builds it up, and he's a problem eliminator. He gets Sanchez's confidence, and then, of course, at the end, he betrays that confidence. And that's another great thing about Sanchez, I think, is that for a man like him, he has this almost, I wouldn't say childish, but he reminds me, it's, you know, like, it reminds me of that school when, you know, I never really had many friends, unsurprisingly, hence why I'm on YouTube. But if I had somebody that was a good friend, I felt immensely grateful for it. And it was, and Sanchez, you know, he's not insecure like I was, but he, Killifer, is an utter piece of shit. He betrays Felix for the sake of $2 million American dollars. And Sanchez is like, well, you know, I don't think he cares. He might sometimes judge a person. I think he's the kind of person that would go home and go, Killifer's a bastard. He betrayed his friend for a couple $1 million. What kind, you know, he's got no principles or something. I think, because this man, by the way, serves bloody tea to Bond. So, I mean, he's got a, and yet, you know, he goes to Killifer, right, here's your $2 million, mate. Thanks for helping me out. You're a star. And Killifer's like, yeah. And of course, Killifer's pay to death is brilliant because, you know, the audience doesn't like him. He's not been in the film long, but you don't like him. He's betrayed Felix and he gets fed to the sharks. And it's got that brilliant line by Sharky, you know, what a waste. And Bond just glares him and goes, of money. And Bond's like, okay, fair enough. And then Sanchez, he likes Bond for being loyal to him and wanting to work for him and being shot up by narcotics and stuff. And it makes it all the better at the end when he realises that Bond has suckered him and he just goes off his nut. And it's like he just has that, the way he likes his mates or people that are loyal to him. And of course those that are disloyal pay the ultimate price, hence hell and meeting a dead end. I mean, Serb plays Crest rather well, I think. If you read the short story, it's Risico. No, it's a Hildebrand rarity. Crest is a piece of work in that. Just minus, it's obviously vastly different to what, like, and that's the thing, you know, this is the first Bond film not really based on a Fleming story and without a Fleming title. I mean, Living Daylights was the last Bond film until Casino Royale, almost 20 years later already. And so his death, it's a muddling one. He's a piece of work, but then he's, you kind of feel for him because it wasn't his fault that, well, it wasn't him that mucked about the money as such. It happened on his watch, but he wasn't the one that, you know, he wasn't purposely out to dick Sanchez. And I think that's Bond's ruthlessness at work. Bond by, he's not, Bond is still Bond. And I like to think, he probably wouldn't know that I said this, but if Fleming had still been alive at that point, he would have been just over 80, so. But I like to think he at least would have liked about License to Kill, that Dalton is still Bond, his Bond, to a point, especially as you can in 1989. The Bond girls are, one's a woman, one's a girl, the way she acts anyway. Lupe, she's all right, very attractive lady is Miss Sato, but she's not the strongest. Oh, I love him so much. It's like, oh God. And the Bond woman is Pam Bouvier, Carrie Lowell, Mrs. Gear, I believe, and she's Bond's equal in more ways than one. Forget the Bond girls that have come during the Craig era. She is Bond's equal. Now, she does have the classic, like, oh, Lord, my mind's just gone totally blank. like Tiffany Case, I don't know. She's her own woman, and then she sort of gets a bit weak at the knees about Bond. But it, thankfully, it doesn't really happen until halfway into the film. The only great shame is that she cuts her hair. There's a fierce debate online, in my courts anyway, about, it makes a difference in my book. Long hair on a woman compliments them better. But you believe that she can handle herself. She's meant to have flown helicopter missions into some outer hellholes on the planet. And Felix wouldn't have, you know, she's more or less the last of Felix's contacts investigating Sanchez that hasn't been killed by Sanchez and his network. She, yeah, it's a shame she didn't come back. I think she, if Dolan had carried on, she could have come back in a fourth film. But the trouble is with returning characters, it doesn't always pay off. And it would, but then I think if Daylights and License to Kill had been directed by somebody else, say Martin Campbell had done License to Kill, it would have been the best Bond film going. And it defines, it didn't get good publicity because of what was going on with MGM from the sounds of it. It got called, it was going to be called License with Vote, and apparently Americans were going to be confused about, they would think it would be about the, you know, car licensing or something, and the film, it just, it's a shame really. And then of course legal troubles happened, and we have to wait 6 years. Now from the sounds of it, Dalton was wrapped up with it in the Bond world until at least 1994. And if, on the match, if George Lazenby and Diamonds Are Forever is one great Bond what if, Dalton doing a third or even fourth and fifth Bond film, is it the other one, I think, and maybe even Brosnan doing a fifth Bond film? Because Glenn wasn't going to be doing Bond forever. He'd done five by the end of License to Kill. He didn't do any others after it. So what if someone like Martin Campbell came along in 1990 and directed a third Bond for 1991, and the Cold War was coming down, I wouldn't say it would be the best Bond film, but Dalton wasn't a bad actor and isn't a bad actor. He doesn't really seem to like mentions of Bond in interviews. He doesn't get a bit fidgety like other actors do, but he, you know, he's an actor, you know. Even if I have seen him in a horrible TV movie, which I think we called Room to Let. So he basically goes on holiday with his kids. He's a single father and meets his woman who runs holiday letting agents, and at the end they fall in love. And he played James Bond. So that's, yeah, and also it goes without saying it's got some fantastic action pieces, especially the truck scene. The only shame is that, you know, it's a soundtrack that hasn't been properly released. Like For You to Kill and Moonraker. So that's the Dalton era. I'm trying to figure out how we're going to do the Brosnans, because I saw GoldenEye the other week for the Pierce Brosnan watch along thingamajig. You know, rest assured, I'm not doing a video for all four films at the same time, because that will go on forever. I mean, if Dr. No through to Thunderball lasted 50 minutes as a video, then I can only imagine that four Brosnan films will be. Yeah, my wheels are broken. Will be as long, if not longer. And then I've got to do the Daniel Craig films, which I'm not really looking forward to. What is that, mate? So thanks very much to whoever has been watching these. And join us at the forum if you want to.